स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। नमस्कार टू ऑल ऑफ यू, वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ ग्रेट मास्टर श्री रामकृष्ण। Yesterday, we had started the study of Madhura Bhava in the spiritual aspirant's life of Sri Ramakrishna. We had gone into the introduction of that particular subject, Madhura Bhava, sweet mood. So the speciality of this mood is, it includes all the other moods. That is the very special thing of this particular mood, Madhura Bhava. It includes the Shanta Bhava. It includes the Dasya Bhava, Sakhya Bhava, friendship. Then Vatsalya Bhava. So all the other moods can be accommodated in this particular mood. And over and above that, some special things also can be included. That's why this is called Madhura Bhava. So liberty, freedom, and also the intensity of being very free, fearless with God is at the highest in this mode. So let us see what Sharda Prabhanandaji Maharaj is taking us through the life of Sri Ramakrishna's Madhura Bhava's mood or that bhava. The history of the spiritual world from the most ancient times to the present day has also on record the description of a few minds whose natural state appeared to be the plane of superconsciousness, but who somehow kept themselves forcibly confined for some time to the plane of that external world for the good of humanity. The more we study the history of Sri Ramakrishna's spiritual strivings, the more shall we understand that his mind belong to this class. If that conviction is not produced in the minds of the readers from a study of this book, the shortcoming of the author should be held responsible for it. Now, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is making himself more humbler and humbler. He has given all the credit to Sri Ramakrishna's life, but while explaining that or bringing that particular aspect of Sri Ramakrishna's spiritual life and make us understand, if he feels that we have not understood it properly or sufficiently, then it is not the mistake of the avatara Sri Ramakrishna, but it is the mistake of the author who is trying to express it. Now we shall go through the words of the humble words of our Sharadanandaji Maharaj. Before that, I will take you through one of the great words or the statement of Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda, at the end of his career, that is life, he proclaimed, "If I have done anything good in this life, if I have done anything good in this life, all the credit goes to my master, Sri Ramakrishna. If I have done anything bad or not good, all that onus or responsibility is of Swami Vivekananda." These were the great humble words of Swami Vivekananda, who proclaimed that anything good done by him, all the credit goes to Sri Ramakrishna. Anything bad, that is mine. I have done that. It is my mistake. Anything good, that belongs to my guru, Sri Ramakrishna. These were the great words. So like that, we can see here, the history of spiritual world from the most ancient times to the present day has also on record the description of few minds whose natural state appeared to be the plane of superconsciousness, but who somehow kept themselves forcibly confined for some time to the plane of external world for the good of humanity. They forcibly brought down the mind, which was always trying to establish itself in the superconscious state, forcibly to this human plane to do good to humanity. The more we study the history of Sri Ramakrishna's spiritual strivings, the more shall we understand that his mind belonged to this class. If that conviction is not produced in the minds of the readers from his study of this book, the shortcomings of the author should be held responsible for it. That is, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is taking the responsibility if there is any shortcomings. Now, the shortcomings of the author should be held responsible for it. For Sri Ramakrishna, the master, said to us repeatedly, Sri Ramakrishna himself is to tell repeatedly, not once. What is that? I, that is Ramakrishna, hold forcibly to one or two trifling desires, with the help of which I keep the mind weighted down for you all. Otherwise, its natural inclination is to remain united and identified with the indivisible one. So now, we shall go through that beautiful statement of Sri Ramakrishna, which will help us to know what is grace, what is karuna, what is compassion of the Lord. If you want to know the real aspect of the karuna, the compassion of the Lord, we have to go through these words of Sri Ramakrishna. What are they? Sri Ramakrishna himself is telling to all the other disciples, his direct disciples and other householder disciples, repeatedly, again and again. What is that? I hold myself forcibly. I hold forcibly to one or two trifling desires, with the help of which I keep the mind weighted down for you all. Otherwise, its natural inclination is to remain united and identified with the indivisible one. So I hold forcibly to one or two trifling desires. Now, with the life of Sri Ramakrishna, the avatar Purusha, now you can understand that some deity, something like that sweet, this deity likes this sweet. It is only out of compassion to hold themselves to this earthly plane to help us, to give us something. They have these trifling desires because they don't need it. They are immersed in that higher superconscious state. These are all trifling things. It doesn't mean anything to them. But they hold on to one or two trifling desires. For example, let us see the great Ganesha, who is the lord of the all, the leader of all the great people of knowledge who have realized God. Ganesha, Gnani Nam Gana, is the leader of the group of the realized soul. Ganesha. So why should he like Modaka or something which we tell? We like all those things. So we want to eat it. That's a special delicacy. But Ganesha likes it to have some one or two trifling desires so that he can come down. As I told you earlier, Bhavamukha threshold. See, if you see the Gajamukha of Sri Ganesha, the Gajamukha of Sri Ganesha, you can remember the Bhavamukha of Sri Ramakrishna. What is that? He has the big elephant head, which represent the superconscious state, the divine state, Parabrahma Swarupa. And his human body of Ganesha represents the earthly existence, this conscious state where we are. So the whole of Ganesha with the elephant head and the human body shows that he is the bridge between these two worlds, the world of this creation where we are in, the human plane, and the superconscious state where the Lord exists. So he is on the in the Bhavamukha, just like Ramakrishna was ordered, commanded by Divine Mother to stay in Bhavamukha many times in his life. So Ganesha's natural state is that. So he will have that desire to eat Modaka or something. He likes this color cloth. He likes this red chandan or sandal paste. He likes that. He likes this. He likes that particular flower. So these liking and other things are only trifling things by which the Lord from that superconscious plane can come down to our level so that he can grace us. We will feel blessed when we offer something. Oh Lord, Ganesha likes it. Let me give this. So it is not for his benefit, but we feel blessed and we will be blessed. We will be benefited. So now from the life of the great avatar Sri Ramakrishna, you can understand why in the scriptures they tell this particular God likes this cloth, particular colored cloth, this particular sweets, this particular eatable. For Devi, we give this paramanna. For Shiva, we give this particular thing to eat during the period of the festivals on that particular day. For Deepavali, we prepare some kind of sweets because some gods like these. On the day of another, this thing, we prepare something because that deity likes these. So these are all for our sake, so that with that trifling thing, the Lord can come down to our plane and then bless us. Just taking that, our offering, seeing that offering and the Shraddha, faith, which we have done all these things, so he will be pleased and he can grace us. That is the idea behind it. So now you can see, by the life of Sri Ramakrishna, avatar Purusha Ramakrishna has come to show us what is our religion, What is our great Hindu religion, the Sanatana Dharma? What is behind all these things? So with every inch, with every moment, with every moment of the life of Sri Ramakrishna, we can find out what is the significance, what is the basis, what is the science. So we can understand the science of religion so nicely. That is the greatness of the life of Avatara, studying the life of Avatara. And one more thing I told, Ganesha Swarupa Sri Ramakrishna, Bhavamukha, he was also in that state. And Ganesha having that elephant head and human body, what does it represent? He's also in that Bhavamukha threshold. That he is, his head is in that superconscious state, Parabrahma Swarupa, his body is in this present active world, the human plane. So anytime it's easy to approach Ganesha because he's in both the planes, human plane and superconscious plane. He's a bridge between that world and this world. So that little desire, trifling desire, Modaka and other things. So we can see here Ramakrishna himself telling, by that we can understand. So many features of different deities, gods and goddesses. You can see, go and see if you study, oh, this particular god, Krishna like this, Krishna like this color, Rama like this, they prepare khichdi to Rama. So many things. So you can see that. You can see. So Sri Ramakrishna is telling, I hold forcibly to one or two trifling desires, with the help of which I keep the mind weighted down for you all, for us, for all of us. Otherwise, its natural inclination is to remain united and identified with the indivisible one, Satchit Ananda, the highest, formless, attributeless, Parabrahma Swarupa, infinity. Now, going forward, let us see. Some of the ancient seers have described the indivisible non-dual reality experienced in Samadhi as the void, that is in Buddhism. And also in Hinduism, that aspect is there, but it is more represented as Shunya in Buddhism. The great emptiness of being. Because in Hinduism, in our Upanishads, it is not only stated that God is Purna, infinite. It is also stated he is the smallest of the smallest. He is the biggest of the biggest. Bigger than the biggest, is the smaller than the smallest. That is how it is maintained in Hinduism, in our Sanatana Dharma, in our Vedas. All aspect has been covered. But in the religion of Buddhism, the sect of Buddhism, what is shown there? More of it is given to Shunya, emptiness. What is the word in our Upanishad which state that the Lord is bigger than the biggest, smaller than the smallest? Anoraniyan, Mahato Mahiyan. Anoraniyan. Anu means atom. Anoho Aniyan, smaller than the atom, smallest. Mahato Mahiyan. Mahataha means biggest. Mahiyan means bigger than the biggest. Superlative degree in both the cases. Smaller than the smallest, bigger than the biggest. Anoraniyan, Mahato Mahiyan. So in some sects, some other groups, they stress on only one aspect, Shunya, emptiness. But in Hinduism, you have both the liberty. Whether you want, you can go to the Purna. Purnasya Purnam Adaya Purnam Eva Avashishyate Purnam Adaha Purnam Idam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnam Adaya Purnam Eva Avashishyate Purnam Adaha. That is complete, Purna, full, big, infinite. That is infinite. What is that? The Parabrahma Swarupa, the Satchit Ananda, indivisible. That is infinite, the Lord, Paramatman. Then Purnam Idam, this created world which we are in, this created world is also infinite. How is that? How can there be two infinities? There cannot be two infinities. The moment there are another infinity, there are two infinities, then that particular one infinity ceases to be infinity because two has come limitation. So, Purnamadav Purnamidam. infinity is that Lord Paramatman. Infinity is this created world from which has come from him. Purnasya purnam adaya. When infinity is subtracted, removed, taken out from that infinity, this created world which is also infinity, is taken out from that greater infinity, then what about purnasya purnam adaya, subtracted, taken out? Purnam eva avashishyate. There, did it become minus or something lost? No. Still infinity only exists. Even infinity, this created world is taken out from it. Purnamadaha purnamidam purnat purnam udachyate. Purnat, from that infinity, purnam, this created world, another infinity, udachyate, is created, is projected. Purnasya purnam adaya. Taking out infinity from that infinity, purnam eva avashishyate, infinity only remains. See, the great truth in mathematics, the mathematics, higher mathematics teaches us, infinity plus infinity is infinity. Infinity minus infinity is infinity. Our rishis and munis had found out this, not only in the linear world of mathematics, but at the all-round world of mathematics, in a different way. See, it is there. Infinity minus infinity is infinity. That is what our Vedic Shanti Mantra, Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avashishyate Satchit Ananda. So, now, that is also not only full infinite, that aspect is stated, but our Upanishad also states, Anoraniya is smaller than the smallest, void, emptiness and fullness, both aspects, you may be more than that. That is what our Upanishads and our great Vedas and also Sri Ramakrishna tells, don't limit God. He may not only be these two, infinite and the smallest. He may be much more than that. Don't limit him. We cannot understand. He may be many, many, many more things. So, some of the ancient seers, our rishis, have described the indivisible non-duality reality experienced in samadhi as the void, shunya, the great emptiness of being, and others as the full, purna, the plenitude of being. What a wonderful word given by the translator of this great master, Swami Jagadanandaji Maharaj. He was expert in English, he was expert in Sanskrit, great stalwart. So that's why I prefer to read this great master, because he was also a great realized soul. So, Sharadanandaji Maharaj, one of the greatest realized soul, writing the life of the Avatara Purusha, and that has been translated into English by another realized soul, Jagadanandaji Maharaj. So, he has translated the Shunya as the great emptiness of being. Then Purna, the full, as the plentitude of being. What a wonderful coining of words. Plentitude of being, purna. As a matter of fact, both of them imply the same experience. As a matter of fact, both the things, the infinite and the emptiness, plentitude of emptiness of the being, is described by Sharadanandaji Maharaj as, they imply the same experience. It's the same thing. The same one, Satchit Ananda, is experienced as void, emptiness, or as plentiness, fullness. Is the same aspect, it is the same fact, both of them imply the same experience, for they have described it as one from which all things come into being and in which they merge. It is just like the stars, great stars, they give life to so many planets, just like our solar system. Much more bigger solar systems may be there, galaxies and the Milky Ways which we see. But when it completely gives out all the light and becomes empty, then it becomes a black hole where everything will be sucked in. Whatever goes nearby, any mass is sucked inside. the black hole, it becomes the black hole, emptiness, void. So both that infinite plenitude and emptiness, you can see. It's only an example, but that is Parabrahman or God. Paramatman is much, much more than that one star or that black hole, might be a spot or a speck, a piece of dust in that infinite creation. Compared to that infinite creation, the Lord is much, much more bigger than that. That's why the Purusha Sukta, one of the Vedic mantras, Purusha Sukta, describes the Lord as Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha Sahasraksha Sahasrapad Sabhumim Vishvato Vritva Sabhumim Vishvataha Avritva Sabhumim Vishvato Vritva Atyatishta Dashangulam. Now, what is the meaning of that? Sabhumim Vishvato Avritva. That Paramatman or the Lord has engulfed not only this created world, even after that, Sabhumim, this earth, this plane, earthly plane of the solar system, with the center, this earth, Sabhumim Vishvataha, the whole universe, so many Akhilanda Koti Brahmanda Janani Janaka. So that Lord is not only this Akhilanda Koti Brahmanda, he is engulfing and covering up, but Avritva Atyatishta Dasha Angulam is much, much more than that when he took that Vamana avatar. Vamana, when he became the Lord Vishnu, became the Vamana, the dwarf. Then he asked for 3 steps only of land from Bali Chakravarti. Recently they celebrated Onam in Kerala. So what is that Onam? So they celebrate the coming of Bali Chakravarti back from the Patala Loka to his world again. So they welcome him. So Bali Chakravarti was great king, and you know, he asked, the Lord asked as a Vamana only for 3 steps, footsteps of land. Yes, you can get it. It was so great to give the Lord himself charity. Giving charity to the Lord Narayana himself, is it a small thing? So Bali Chakravarti, though he was a demon, he agreed, yes, I'm going to. His guru stopped him, Shukracharya, but he agreed, I will give. Then what did that dwarf do, Vamana? He grew and grew, cosmic form, so infinite. With just 1 foot, he measured the whole earth, covered the whole earth. Then with another step, he covered the whole external universe. Then he told, Where can I get my 3rd step? You had promised me to give me 3 steps. Now I have covered 2 steps. With just 2 steps, I have covered the whole created universe and this earth. Now you have given me 2 things, but you don't own anything else now. The earth is finished and the external world is also finished. I have covered it. Where is the last step? Then the only thing which he had was, Bali Chakravarti told, my head. You can place it on my head, O Lord. Then the Lord Vishnu placed him. Because of that weight, he went down to the Patala Loka. So, even after measuring these 3 things, Atyatishta Dashangulam, he was much, much more, the Lord Paramatman is much, much more bigger than this created universe and this earth. You can see the vastness, the infinity of the Lord. So here, for they have described it as one from which all beings come into being and in which they merge. Everything merges back into it. The reality that has been called by the Buddha as the void, the shunya, in which all beings get extinguished, has been described by Shankara, the great monist, as the full, the purna, which constitutes the unmodified substratum of them all. If we leave aside the opinions of the later Buddhist teachers and study Buddha and Shankara, we irresistibly come to this conclusion. The plane of the non-dual consciousness implied in the concept of the void and the full has been described in the Upanishad or the Vedanta as the state beyond all ideation. A state beyond all ideation, ideal. It is beyond all ideation, state of ideation, beyond all ideation. For perfectly established in it, the mind of the aspirant transcends the limit of all other planes of consciousness produced by God's play of creation, preservation, and dissolution, and merges in homogeneity. Therefore, the non-dual state of consciousness is something non-relational, different from the five moods, such as the Shanta, Dasya, etc. There are no moods. It is homogeneity. So where the real aspect of God, the plane of consciousness produced by God's play of creation, preservation, and dissolution, and merges in homogeneity. Therefore, the non-dual state, the one without the second, the non-dual state of consciousness is something non-relational, no relation, no division. So it's non-relation, different from the five moods. It is beyond the five moods, different from the five moods, such as the Shanta, Dasya, etc., with the aid of which the limited human mind enters the spiritual realm. So with the aid of these five moods, our mind, human mind, enters the spiritual realm. They are the steps, and becomes bound up with God in an eternal relation. Only when man becomes absolutely indifferent to all kinds of enjoyments, whether of this world or of the next, and attains on the strength of purity a position higher than that of the gods, he comes to the non-dual mode. So in the sannyasa, when they are giving the sannyasa, the guru will give the Presha mantra, which is very, very important. Presha means the rudder, which gives us the direction. It is a very sacred mantra, which cannot be told or given to anybody. Only when they get sannyasa, the guru has to give them. So in that, the same idea comes. What is that idea? Which Sharadanandaji Maharaj is given the essence of that Presha mantra. And what is that essence of the Presha mantra given by Sharadanandaji Maharaj here? The essence is only when man becomes absolutely indifferent to all kinds of enjoyment, man should give up, absolutely become indifferent to all kinds of enjoyments, the worldly enjoyments, whether of this world or of the next, whether of this world, the enjoyments of this world or of the next, and attains on the strength of purity a position higher than that of the gods, he comes to that non-dual mode. That is Presha, means rudder. Presha mantra will goad us to give up all the enjoyments of not only of this world, but of the next worlds too. Go beyond even gods, the small letter gods. So that's the idea of Presha mantra, rudder. It will guide us to that non-dual mood. He comes to that non-dual mood. With the help of this, he realizes the attributeless Brahman. No attributes at all, no guna, no qualities, in which the whole universe together with God, its creator, preserver, and destroyer, has its eternal being, and on the attainment of which the acme, the highest of life, is reached. Leaving aside the non-dual mode and the attributeless Brahman attainable with its help, we need the aspirants of bhakti cults, the devotional cults, speaking of the manifestation of the five moods. Now we have been given the reality to some extent of that Akhanda, Satchit, Ananda, Parabrahma, Swarupa, the highest. We are taken to that. What is that greatness? What is that infinity? Has all been told now. Sharada Nandaji Maharaj has explained about the both the aspects and many more other different aspects of the void, complete void, and the fullness, and which is beyond that everything we have been taken through. Now let us come down to the devotional aspect, where leaving aside the non-dual mode, which is beyond everything, because we are living in this world of ideation, that is beyond the ideation. It goes beyond the world of ideation. Nothing, no ideas at all, no ideals at all, no bhava in that. So we are in this world of ideation, ideals, principle. So leaving aside, it's very, very difficult to go there. We can't even think of it at now. So we shall be satisfied with some of the local things, leaving aside the non-dual mood and the attributeless Brahman, attainable with its help. We find the aspirants of bhakti, cults, speaking of the manifestation of the five modes, pancha bhava, namely shanta. What is shanta? Placid attitude. Placid attitude. No relationship of enmity. Shanta bhava with God is shanta. Placid attitude. Dasya. A servant's attitude. Sakya. Comradely attitude. Friendship. Vatsalya. Parental attitude. And madhura. Conjugal attitude. So now we are coming to this madhura bhava, conjugal attitude. The object attainable through each of these is Brahman with attributes, or Ishvara, the Lord with attributes, the Lord with form. We are going to attain, if you take up any of these, any one of these attributes, sorry, the bhavas, the attitudes, then where do we go and reach? We reach that Brahman, or the Lord with attributes, or Ishvara, who is all controlling, who is all powerful, and by nature eternally pure, awakened and free, who does all this srishti, sthiti, pralaya, the creation, maintenance and sustenance. The aspirant tries to know him in the relation corresponding to one or the other of those of these modes. He assumes himself. And he, the Lord, who is the inner controller of all beings, it is not only immanent, sarvavyapi, everywhere, but also is the indweller, antaryami, the inner controller of ours. He is dwelling within us. Not only is everywhere outside, is within us too, the inner controller. So the Lord, who is the inner controller of all beings and the repository of all moods, is a repository, that is Gunashraya in Devi, the Divine Mother's Stotra, we do Sarvamangala Mangalye. There we get the words Gunashraye Gunamaye. It is full of these qualities, Sattva, Rajas, and Tamas. Guna Ashraye. She is also the repository, the base, the repository of all these qualities. So here you can see the Lord, who is the inner controller of all beings and the repository of all moods, repository of all moods, all these attitudes, any attitude, any mood, the Lord is the repository, sees the single-minded devotion of the aspirant, and in order to help him in developing the mood, reveals himself to him in the form appropriate to it, and thus blesses him. So the Lord will appear, take the form. The Lord will take the attributes appropriate to the mood of the spiritual aspirant and helps him to come up and attain that position, that infinity. So that's how the Lord comes down. That is Avatarana coming down. So the Lord, who is the inner controller of all beings and the repository of all moods, sees the single-minded devotion of the aspirant, and in order to help him in developing the mood, reveals himself to him in the form appropriate to it, and thus blesses him, whatever mood he may be in. The five moods are only the generalization. In between those moods, there is no watertight compartment. You can see so many other moods interspersed. There may be more than these five moods. As I told you, there is the Apta Bhava, there is the Veera Bhava. So many other bhavas may be there which we do not know. This generalized thing has been put into five modes other than that, in tantric modes, there may be so many other modes, infinite modes. So that's why here it has been told, the repository of all modes, the Lord, who is the inner controller of all the beings and the repository of all modes, sees the single-minded devotion of the aspirant, and in order to help him in developing that mood, reveals himself to him in the form appropriate to it, and thus blesses him. So each devotee, each aspirant is a path to himself. That is the reason why Sri Ramakrishna has told, as many people, so many paths. That is the reason you can find why there are 330 million of gods and goddesses. That means infinite number of gods. So the Lord, one God, infinite, formless, attributeless, will take the forms based on our different moods, our attitude, our likings, abhiruchi, our state of evolution. So he accordingly, he is so compassionate, accordingly, according to our mood, wherever we are, he takes different forms and attributes to help us to go up, just like a springboard. All those avatars, the deities, the gods and goddesses are just like the springboard from which we can go to the next. We will be given a flight to the next stage. So it is thus that God, who is pure consciousness, assumes in different ages various forms that are the embodiments of these different moods, attitudes. We read in the scriptures, incarnates himself even as a man to fulfill the desires of the devotees. The five moods are the subtle and purified form of those mundane relations by which human beings are bound to one another in their daily lives. The five moods are nothing but the subtle and purified forms of the mundane relations by which human beings are bound to one another in their daily lives. So with all these five moods, we are related to each other in this life, human life. So when that moods, which helps us to get related in this mundane, the mundane relationship in this ordinary life, when it is given a godwardly turn, purified, made subtle, then that becomes, the same thing becomes the bhava, pancha bhavas, the five moods. We are conscious of particular relation with father. We are conscious about the relationship with our mother, with the husband, with the wife, with the friends, just like the male friend and female friend, with the master servant, the son, daughter, king, subject, teacher, disciple, and so on. See, there was one more mood, guru, shishya. That is another relationship which we never took cognizance. Now, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is mentioning that the king and the subject, teacher, and the disciple, then, and so on, so many things more may be there. And we feel also that with the exception of enemies, that is Shanta Bhava, the relationship between the enemy and enemy, that is also a relationship. That's an exception, and that is Shanta Bhava. Some people try to have relation with God through that also. What is that relation as an enemy? Can you remember who they are? Ravana with Lord Ramachandra, Hiranyakashipu with Lord Narayana or Vishnu, Hiranyaksha, Kamsa. They had that relationship as enemies. Why? Intense hatred. What is that? Intense hatred? So what is hatred? Hatred is another form of love. How do you define hatred? When you don't get something, you start hating it. You want to possess something, you cannot get it. Then what do? You start hating it. Just like that fox tried to jump and get that beautiful sweet grapes. in that vineyard or the grape yard. So it was trying to jump and get it. It was too high, it couldn't get it. Then what was that statement of the fox after much trial? The dirty grapes are sour, useless, worthless. Start hated the grapes and went away. It tried to get it. It had love for that. But when it couldn't get it, it started hating it. So intense hatred is nothing but another form of love, intense love. You cannot get it, it turns into hatred. So some aspirants have reached God through that too. So it is told here, with the exception of enemies, that is Shanta Bhava, no enmity. But there is also a relation, I told you that Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, that Kamsa, Ravana, all these people got God very quickly by intense hatred. That was also a relationship, but our scriptures tell not to have that relationship as an enemy. That's not worth. So that is also there. So exception of enemies, we should behave towards all others in a calm, shanta, and respectful attitude of mind. The teachers of bhakti have classified those relations into 5 divisions of shanta and the rest mentioned above, and advised people to take up one or another of these modes, for practice and establish themselves in loving relationship with the divine. For it is easy for jivas to try to know God with the help of these 5 modes, the nature of which is already known to them in their worldly relationships. So we know that it's easy. It's natural to us. So just turn it towards God. It will be very easy to establish relationship with God and move forward quickly. That is not all. Those modes, which while based on the worldly relationship rooted in desires, produce only aversion, attachment, and other similar modification that impel men to commit various evil actions. When oriented towards God, the same thing which would goad us or force us to do wrong things, commit evil actions, will now, if directed towards God, when oriented towards God, helps the aspirants advance towards the realization of God by their irresistible original impetus without their worldly corruption. Take for example, now Sharadananda Maharaj is taking the example of lust. Take for example lust, kama, which is a disease, so to say, of the heart and the cause of all miseries. The cause of all the miseries, most of the miseries, is this lust, kama. So take for example lust, which is a disease, so to say, of the heart and the cause of all miseries. Now, how do you know that it is the disease and it is the cause of all miseries? These are the words of Lord Krishna himself when Arjuna asks Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, "O Lord, we don't want to commit sins. We don't want to do wrong things. But something in us, some force in us, forces us to takes away our mind forcibly to do, commit sins. What is that? I can't understand. Why do we do these sinful acts? We don't want to. Nobody wants to commit sins. But somehow something forces us. What is that, O Lord?" Then Krishna answers when he asks the questions in Bhagavad Gita. "Kama eshah, krodha eshah, rajo guna samudbhavah, maha ashano maha papma, vidyena miha vairinam. Kama eshah, this kama, lust. Krodha eshah, this anger. Krodha eshah, rajo guna samudbhavah." They are the combination of this rajas, intense activity, rajas, rajoguna samudbhavah, maha ashana. They are great fire. Ashana means fire. The great fires which can destroy anything. So Krishna terms them, this lust and anger, as fire. Maha ashana, maha papma. They are great sinful things which forces us to commit sins. महाअशन महापापम विद्येन मिह वैरिणम नो फसटेन ओ अर्जुन दिस लस्ट एंड एंगर आर योर वर्स्ट ऑफ द एनिमीज स्टेटमेंट ऑफ लॉर्ड कृष्ण दे आर द वर्स्ट ऑफ योर एनिमीज दे आर फायर ग्रेट फायर दे आर ग्रेट सिंफुल प्रोपेलेंट्स दिस काम एंड क्रोध लॉर्ड कृष्ण टेल्स बट लॉर्ड कृष्ण हैज टोल्ड दीज थिंग्स शुडंट वी बी केयरफुल टू गिव देम अप द लस्ट एंड एंगर क्रोध काम एंड क्रोध Yeah, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling. What is that? This, take for example, the lust, which is a disease, so as to say, of the heart and the cause of all miseries. Cause of all miseries, whatever miseries we have, causes this intense desire, kama, lust. So Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling, it's a disease, so to say, the heart of the heart and the cause of all miseries. But when you direct that towards God, it will manifest as desire for God vision. The same thing when directed towards God will manifest as desire for God vision. The aspirant's anger will now be directed against the things. When you turn anger for spiritual purposes in this mode, how will it help you? That which was destroying you, which was burning you, the anger, and be the cause of so much of evil in your life. When that anger turned towards God, what will happen? The aspirant's anger will now be directed against the things and persons that are obstacles on the path to that vision. Whatever will oppose, cause be a hurdle towards God realization. It will be turned as an anger to that particular thing. So the aspirant's anger will now be directed against the things and persons that are obstacles on the path of that vision. They will now become mad. They will now become mad after and infatuated with the enjoyment of the wonderful beauty and the love of God, noticing the unique splendor of spirituality. In persons who have succeeded in attaining the holy vision of God, the culmination of blessedness, they will now become anxious to have it themselves. So now how beautifully, scientifically, logically, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is taking us through the secrets and the logic which is happening behind the scene. What is happening there in these moods? What is this bhakti? What are the moods? What are the attitudes? What will happen? How to guide it? So beautifully is explained. Now we can apply them in our life. Very beautiful, isn't it? So we cannot say with any certainty that the teachings on these five modes of loving relation to God were promulgated by any particular teacher at any particular time. But many great souls appeared in India because it is the birthright of every saint, every spiritual aspirant. No particular one teacher has promulgated this or discovered this or given this to us. Maybe some teachers may be showing it in a better way, that's all. But it is the birthright of everyone. So we cannot say with any certainty that the teachings on these five modes of loving relations to God were promulgated by any particular teacher at any particular time. But many great souls appeared in India. Many, many great souls appeared in India. And now too, there are great souls who are appearing in India. In future too, it will be there. That's why India is called as the great karma bhumi, the great pavitra bhumi. India is not an ordinary land. It is called pavitra bhumi, karma bhumi, because from time immemorial, great saints are born again and again. And even now they are being born. In future too, it will produce saints after saints after saints after saints. That is the speciality of India. No other country, no other society, no other religions have produced so many great people like in India. Sure. That's why Swami Vivekananda tells, take the torchlight. of the Olympics of the Greeks. I will come with you. Swami Vivekananda's statement. Take me to all the societies and nations. Show one country like India, which have produced such great people. That's why Swami Vivekananda tells, shall India die? Shall India perish? If India perishes, all that is good, all that is spiritual, all that is great will be destroyed. India can never perish. India can never die. Because if India dies, then all that is good, all that is spiritual, all that is beneficial will die, will get destroyed. Can it happen? No. Why? Because India has produced and is producing, and in future too, in present, saints after saints after saints and great people after great people. So, because it is saturated, because it is made divine by the foot dust of all these great souls, India cannot die. These are the words of Swami Vivekananda. So many saints were there and will be now and in future too. Many great souls appeared in India. This great hermitage of the world. India is the great hermitage of the world. See the words conned by Sharadanandaji Maharaj. Great souls appeared in India. This great hermitage of the world. India is called the great hermitage of the world. At different times and engaged themselves in practices for the realization of God. The civilization itself, the religion, so the backbone, the pranapakshi, the life force of this country is dharma, religion, finding God, realizing God. That is the backbone of this country. That is the pranapakshi. That is the goading force of this country. So can it get destroyed? No, never. If it changes this, then this country will get destroyed. If you change the goal of this country from religion or from righteousness, finding that dharma, God realization, then this country will perish. The whole world will perish. It cannot happen. So this hermitage of the world, India, this great hermitage of the world at different times and engaged, it has produced many great souls, who have engaged themselves in practices of the realization of God. So realization of the God is the motto of this country, India. Can you show me one country in this globe or outside which is striving, which is spent its full force on realization of God? Can you? No. So all the great saints engage themselves in the practices for the realization of God through one, two or more of these modes, and having made the Lord their own by means of their extraordinary love, taught men to do likewise. When we study the unique lives of these teachers, it becomes clear that only the love of God is at the root of the sadhana of those modes, and that the said love has always for its object one or other of the numerous expressions of that personal aspect of God. Personal aspect of God. Now, what is that at the root of all these devotions or religion? When we study the unique lives of these great teachers, the great seers, the great saints, it becomes clear that only the love for God. So now it has been made clear. Everything is being made clear. What is that behind all this devotion and everything religious life? It is love of God. That is the essence. Love of God is the essence. So that is the speciality of this book, Great Master, Study of the Great Master. We are being taken through the essence of everything. No confusion. Clear, crystal clear. Everything is made clear. If you can't understand this and go forward in spiritual life, then what is the use? So Sharadanandaji Maharaj has been given this beautiful duty by none other than the great avatar Sri Ramakrishna to bring in. Swami Vivekananda told, when somebody asked him, you are the right person, you have understood Ramakrishna rightly. So you have to write the life of Sri Ramakrishna. I told, refuse, no. If I go to strive, I cannot. I may make it to go. I may to prepare a Shiva idol. If I go, I may make it a monkey out of it. I am incapable. The Lord has chosen somebody else. And who is that? The great Sharada Nandaji Maharaj has been chosen for the greatest avatar of this period. And Sharada Nandaji Maharaj is telling us, opening up everything threadbare and giving us the essence. When we study the unique lives of these teachers, it becomes clear that only the love of God in religion, what is very, very necessary, we forget that. Love of God is at the root of the sadhanas. Every sadhana, what is the propelling force? What should be there? Love of God. Without that, do any amount of sadhana, useless. What is the propelling force? What is the petrol? What is the fuel which you should have while doing sadhana as a spiritual aspirant? Love of God is at the root of all sadhanas, of those moods. And that the said love has always for its object one or other of the numerous expressions of the personal aspect of God. For as long as man does not experience the non-dual reality, which is the last word, how to attain that non-dual reality, it's very, very difficult. So until, as long as man does not experience the non-dual reality, so long is he bound to have the conception and experience of God only as person. You cannot otherwise go beyond it. Only with this help, with this grace, you can go beyond that form. It is just like while explaining about the religion, Swami Vivekananda tells, what is that? Now suppose from tomorrow or today, all the buffaloes want to have a conception of God. Then they will all meet together. And what will be their conception of God? They cannot think beyond the buffalo world, buffalo God. So the great big, the biggest of the buffalo with a golden horn, sitting on a golden throne, big fat buffalo with a golden horn and golden throne, beautiful, darkest of the buffaloes, giving thousands of milk, can be the ideal of the buffalo world. If all the buffaloes want to have a conception of God, they cannot think beyond buffaloes. Great buffalo, big buffalo, the darkest buffalo with a big golden horn, sitting on a golden throne, giving thousands of milk, can be their concept, that's all. They can't go beyond buffalo world. Likewise, we too in this human world, we can't go beyond human beings. So at the most, we may think of the best human form, the divine Lord with all that this thing. So we can't go beyond until we reach that infinite. But it's very, very difficult. For as long as man does not experience the non-dual reality, so long is he bound to have the conception and experience of God only as a person with form. So where is the question? Some people of the Semitic religion, Abrahamic religions, tell that infinity, infinity. Come on, tell me. Can you, what feeling do you get when you tell infinite or formless? You can't even imagine what is formless. You are bound to think of form only. Even when you tell formless, close your eyes and think formless, you'll be seeing some forms. Your mind, finite mind and finite indriyas, the senses cannot think until you go. That is, all the population of this, maybe billions population, one or two can think of that infinite. What about the rest? You have to think of God only as a person. Can't go beyond that. And now these people criticize about idol worship with form. What do they know about religion? What do they have? Experienced anything? No basis, no experience at all. Our Indians, the great saints of India, the rishis, I have taken up religion from time immemorial, 50, 60,000 years. It is time tested. No bloodshed, no killing in the name of religion and God. So much of freedom. And it has come over years and years, millennia, 50, 60,000 years. And no problem. Everything is going on well. 100 years or 1,000 years, so much of bloodshed, so much of killing, which never happened in India, in Hinduism. Every religion is accommodated. Buddhism, Buddha came as a rebel child of Hinduism. He criticized everything in the Hinduism. And all the anomalies or mistakes were rectified. Indians, Hindus were very happy. They rectified that. The Jain saints came. They criticized. They rectified it. So many other saints came, Kabir, Basavanna, and so many people. They criticized, these are the wrong means. They accommodated them. They corrected themselves. Show one religion which have done that. Every Tom, Dick, and Harry comes and criticizes. They accommodate everybody. They have never killed any prophet. Show one this thing. All prophet in the Semitic religions have been killed, poisoned or killed, crucified. But Buddha, criticizing Hinduism and Vedas, lived for full 80 years. Nobody thought of even killing him. They gave the place to the Charvakas, the materialist who is to criticize everything in the religion. The Rishi, the place of the Rishis, that is Hinduism. That is Sanatana Dharma, that is a religion of India. So now, here Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling, bringing us to the reality. Don't be foolish to think that, oh, I will think of infinity. I'll worship infinity. How do you worship? They tell, the Lord, infinite Lord is sitting in the clouds in a throne. One who is formless, one who is infinite, how can he sit on a throne on a cloud? Why does he need a cloud or a throne to sit? Who is infinite? Who is formless? Why does he want a throne, that too, a golden throne? So, you can see the reality. This practical experience should be there. No impractical things here. So, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling, as long as man does not experience the non-dual reality, so long is he bound to have the conception and experience of God only as a person, worshipping God as a person, as a human being. We cannot go beyond that. Only when we have the non-dual knowledge, it's not just knowledge, experience it. Then only you can go beyond this personal God. Until then, you have to be established in this devotional mode. You have to establish and go forward gradually. And that Lord, personal God, that Ishvara will, out of his grace, will lift you to that infinite or give you that knowledge of the non-dual reality. When we study the progress of love between two lovers, now coming to this Madhura Bhava, conjugal attitude, when we study the progress of love between two lovers, we find how it obliterates. What is the important thing in this conjugal love or attitude of relation of conjugal relationship with God? When we study the progress of love between two lovers, we find how it obliterates, it removes the distance, the difference created by their respective positions and powers in their worldly situation. So that either the husband or the wife or the lovers may be at different positions. One may be very high, one may be very low. But in that relation, when we study the progress of love between two lovers, we find how it obliterates, removes the distance, the difference created by their respective positions and powers in their worldly situations. Similarly, love removes by degrees from the mind of the spiritual aspirant engaged in the sadhana of any of these modes his consciousness of God's unlimited powers. So that fear, that difference, that God is very big, unlimited, so much of power, he is powerful. all that fear goes away. When you establish this relationship, conjugal relationship, just like the difference and the fear goes away between the lovers, whether they may be of a high caste or a low caste or difference in position, education, all the difference vanishes when the love progresses, when the progress of the love between the two lovers, we find how it obliterates the distance and difference created by the respective positions and powers in their worldly situations. Similarly, love, bhakti, devotion to God removes by degrees, step by step, from the mind of the spiritual aspirant engaged in the sadhana of any of these modes, his consciousness of God's unlimited powers, and teaches him to regard God as but his beloved according to his particular mode. So we become close and close and close, and finally we become one with that Lord. Therefore, the aspirant's treading this path makes him entirely his own. He makes God his own by means of love. That is important in devotion. You make God your own by this devotion or love, and does not at all hesitate to request. He does not, when he becomes closer and closer to God, he does not at all hesitate to request importune. A very nice fight also can ensue between them. You can also fight with God, quarrel with God, importune, request importune, or even scold him. There are so many bhajans, there are so many stotras, there are so many devotional songs. They are called Ninda Stotra, Ninda. They will criticize God, they will scold God. That Ninda Stotras are there. So beautifully they will fight with God. If you go to great saints, some portion of their time they will be criticizing God also, fighting with God. They are called Ninda Stotras. People enjoy with that. Oh Lord, I don't want you. Go, get lost. For me, your name is enough. Why do I want you? Why do I want to depend upon you? For me, your name is enough. For me, your name is enough. The strength of the name, your name is enough. Get lost, I don't want you. So they quarrel like that. It's all squeak quarrel, just like between the child and the mother, child and the father, brother to brother, or lovers. Importuning the Lord, you can importune, you can force the Lord. You can be so intimate with him, you will not hesitate to request importune or even scold him out of his sense of loving intimacy with him. I have heard many devotees telling that not only they have scolded him, they have fought with him. They literally fight with the Lord. I have known so many devotees telling that they have expressed it. The Ishtadevata, they love him so much that they have pushed the photo. They fought with him. So that love, when intensified, you can do that. God will not be unhappy with that. He'll be very happy with you. Because it's out of devotion, love for the Lord. So, therefore, the aspirant treading in this path makes him entirely the Lord his own. Or even scold by means of love, and does not at all hesitate to request importune, or even scold him out of his sense of loving intimacy with him. The more the practice of one of these five modes enables the aspirant to forget the powers of God. What is important? You have to forget the powers of God. You have to feel God is your own, your near and dear one. You'll forget your father may be the biggest judge. Your father may be the president of your country. But will the child or the wife be afraid of that person? Whether he may be a person, police officer, biggest police officer. He might be the judge. Will the child of the judge or the wife of that judge be afraid of him? No, not at all. Like that, when you become close to God, whether he may be the creator of the universe, he may be the destroyer of the universe, there is no fear at all. Your oneness, your cloak, get so close to God. That is the secret of devotion. The more the practice of one of these five modes enables the aspirant to forget the powers of God. Forgetting the powers of God is very, very important. Forget the powers of God. That is very important. Be close to God. So to forget the powers of God and experience nothing else but his love. Experience nothing else but his love and sweetness. the more exalted is it regarded in this sadhana. The more you experience the sweetness, the love and intimacy, the more you forget the powers of God, then the more you are advancing. Exalted is it regarded in this sadhana of the modes. The more you forget the powers of God and become more and more intimate, nothing else but is love and sweetness, the more exalted is it regarded in this sadhana of modes. It is only from this point of view that the teachers of bhakti, devotion, have ascribed superiority or inferiority to each of these five modes. Amongst the five modes, the shanta is at the lowest level. So superiority, inferiority will be there. The next step is, after that is a little more advanced is the dasya. Then a little more above is the sakya, friendship. A little more above is the vatsalya or aptabhava, like my father, like my mother. The highest they tell is madhura bhava, conjugal. So it's only from this point of view, that is forgetting the power of God and becoming more and more intimate with God, that the teachers of the bhakti have ascribed superiority or inferiority to each of these five modes and have assigned what? The highest place, and have assigned the highest place to the madhura bhava. And they have assigned the highest place to the madhura bhava. Otherwise, each one of them is, as those teachers have unanimously admitted, each one of them are capable of making the aspirant realize God. But from this point of view, what is that? Making you forget the power of God. That superiority or inferiority to each of these five modes have been assigned, the highest place to Madhura Bhava, because of the intimacy, that which will make you more intimate. You have more power over the Lord. You can be more possessive over the Lord. So that's why this conjugal attitude, the Madhura Bhava, has been given the highest place by the teachers. But regardless of that, otherwise each one of them is, as those teachers have unanimously admitted, each one of them are capable of making the aspirant realize God. Each one of them are capable. But here, this is the highest. So now you can see how the mothers, the ladies are at a greater position, advantage, are more lucky to go more closer to God than men. But even in devotion, women are placed very high, because they are naturally in a position to think of God as husband. That's how the Pativrata, the resolve is given. The husband can be taught as God, because the Lord, in every being, human being, the Lord exists. So the wife is in it a better advantage to realize God very quickly. She can become the most powerful in spiritual life. So they are at a greater advantage than at men. Men have to assume that attitude, and with great difficulty do that. But for women, it is natural. So fast they can go by assuming that attitude of Madhura Bhava, seeing God as the husband or the lover. It's very natural and very fast. So more than men, women have an advantage, and God has given them more capability and also partiality to go forward in spiritual life very quickly. So only we have to use it. If you don't use this opportunity, what will be the use? If you don't use this opportunity, what will be the use? So we have to make use of that opportunity, and we turn all our energies and everything to the worldly plane, to the worldly relationship. That's why they are considered as the highest. They respect them. The houses is the highest. Mother is given the highest place. But if you turn that towards God, still higher you can go. Advantage, if you use it. So it's only from this point of the view. What is that point? forget the power of God and experience nothing else but His love and sweetness, the more exalted is it regarded in this sadhana of moods. If you become more intimate, more close to God, forget His power, enjoy sweetness. So based on this, the teachers of the bhakti devotion have ascribed superiority or inferiority to each of these five moods and have assigned the highest place to the Madhura Bhava. Otherwise, each one of them is, as those teachers have unanimously admitted, capable of making the aspirant realize God. So in any path, take anyone, your vyakulata, your eagerness, your earnestness to realize God is the fuel. So take any path, you can move very, it will take you to the same goal. But here, advantage is more. Easy, it is made easy. The path is very easy with this attitude. So it is known from the study of the history of religions that with the ultimate development of any of the five moods, with the ultimate development of any of the five moods, the aspirant forgets himself and feels happy. The aspirant forgets himself. The forgetting himself, see again, I'm taking back you to the essence of religion or the spiritual path. What is that essence? Basic foundation, removal of ego, perfect self-abnegation, removal of selfishness is the basis, is the foundation of spiritual life. Giving up ego. You develop ego, then you are far, far, far away in spiritual life. So here in this mood too, in devotion to removal of your selfishness. I first, everything should be given first. The chair to be reserved for me only. I have to get the food first. I have to be given the first place. Everybody should respect me. Everybody should be under my command. I am the superior one. Ego doesn't work in spiritual life. You will be the lowest in spiritual life. If you want to progress in spiritual life, give up your ego, haughtiness. Give up your selfishness. Then only you can go forward. Forgetting this basics of spiritual life, we think we are great spiritual aspirants and make our ego bloated and we think we are great spiritual aspirants. No, the basics of spiritual life is perfect self-abnegation, removal of your ego, removal of your selfishness. So it is known from the study of the history of religions that with the ultimate development of any of these five modes, the aspirant forgets himself, forgets his selfishness, forgets his ego. That is important. The aspirant forgets himself and feels happy when the object of his love is happy. Many times I have explained this. Even in Jatadhari's case, when the Lord Ramachandra, the baby Ramachandra, wanted to remain with Ramakrishna, then Jatadhari became very happy because he is happy in the service of his Ishtadevata. Whatever that baby Rama wants to and be happy, he is ready to give that. He is not happy with his own possessiveness. If Rama, the child Rama, if you are happy with staying with Ramakrishna, be happy. Your happiness is my happiness. So that is the basics of spiritual life. That is devotion, true devotion. That is true love. That is the highest Shuddha Bhakti, pure love, highest devotion. So the aspirant forgets himself and feels happy when the object of his love is happy. The aspirant feels happy when the object of his love is happy, absorbed in the thought of him, the Lord, during the time of separation from him. He sometimes loses even the consciousness of his own existence. You can see that in the life of Mother Radha in Sita. When in Lanka, Sri Lanka, when he was in that Ashokavana, it was just a dead body, Mother Sita. To go near her, they used to tell it was only the sound was Rama, 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 Rama. No other thought than Rama, Mother Sita in that Ashokavana. But for that Rama, thought of Rama, it was a dead body. Sita didn't have any other thing. Rama, 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 Rama. Rama alone. In Radha also, Krishna, nothing but Krishna. When she couldn't see Krishna's separation, that pain of separation, also devotion to the Lord. absorbed in the thought of the Lord during the time of separation from Him, that aspirant sometimes loses even the consciousness of his own existence, even divine dispassion, separation, the pain of separation also will lead you to the Lord. The pain also, the pain of separation from the Lord will also lead you to Lord. Everything can be used. Every bit of your life can be used for God realization. Only you have to turn it towards God. Otherwise, it will be pain and pain and pain and suffering. You can see in your own life so much of suffering. Turn it towards God. That will itself goad you, pull you towards God. Even the pain, even the separation, the pang of separation. Divine dispassion, it's called divine dispassion. Pang of separation. So absorbed in the thought of the Lord during the time of separation from Him, the aspirant sometimes loses even the consciousness of his own existence completely. Ego, his own existence is removed completely. Perfect self-abnegation. From the study of devotional books like the Bhagavata, we study during the Krishna Janmashtami. In future, if the Lord gives us an opportunity, we can take up that and study Bhagavata also. From the study of devotional books like the Bhagavata, it is seen that not only did the gopis of Vraja, the head, the chief of gopis was Radha. Not only did the gopis of Vraja forget in this way their own existence, but actually felt on occasions identified with their beloved Krishna. All of the gopis would become Krishnas themselves. They would become Krishnas themselves. All of the gopis of Vraja forgot in this way their own existence, but actually felt on occasions identified with their beloved Krishna. It is well known from the devotional books of the Christians that especially the Catholic Christians, not Protestant Christians, it's the Catholic Christians that absorbed in the thought of the Passion of Christ, some mystics bore the stigmata and bled from those marks on their bodies wherever Jesus Christ was crucified. And from that parts, even these saints, the Saint Francis of Assisi and so many other saints, had that mark of stigmata. They would bleed. They would enjoy the pain of Jesus Christ for themselves, whatever Jesus Christ underwent. So it has been told here, it is well known from the devotional books of the Catholic Christians that absorbed in the thought of the Passion of Christ, some mystics bore the stigmata and bled from those marks on their bodies. The life of Saint Francis of Assisi and Saint Catherine of Siena. You could find that stigmata in both of them and many other saints too. It may not be known. So, life of Saint Francis of Assisi and Saint Catherine of Siena. So, therefore, we find that with the final development of each one of these five moods, the aspirants become absorbed in the thought of his or her object of love, and united and identified with him under the strong impulse of love, realize that will take us to non-dual state of consciousness. That will take us to state of non-dual consciousness. I think we'll end our study here. We have completed our time. So what a beautiful study of what is the real thing which happens in devotion. What is the science of devotion? We learned the things so nicely. Shardanandaji Maharaj has let that bare, everything made it so clear. And we could understand what is devotion, how to make use of every worldly things in our life, anger, our lust, our greed, our that divine separation, the pain also, the pain also. All the pains of our life, the fears of our life also can be turned to God. It will take us to non-dual consciousness. It will lead us in. Turn everything. Do you have fear? Turn it towards God. Coronavirus has come. The fear will be there. Fear of life, fear of so many things. Turn it towards God. It will become devotion. Whatever you turn towards God, it becomes devotion. I have got one beautiful saying in the what you call the devotional aspect, and in that you can see that so beautifully expressed. And what is that? When bhakti enters food, eating, craving for food will be there. When bhakti, devotion, if you make it as a tool of devotion, food becomes prasad. Otherwise, you are a glutton. That hotel, that restaurant, you want this and that. That I have to eat, this I have to eat. So when bhakti, you turn it towards God, enters food, becomes prasad. When bhakti enters water, water becomes amrita, charanamrita, tirtha. When bhakti enters traveling, you will have that, there will be wheels in your legs, you want to go here and there, move, turn it towards God. When bhakti enters traveling, travel becomes tirtha yatra, pilgrimage. When bhakti enters music, you love to hear music. Hear devotional songs, turn it towards God, music becomes kirtan, bhajan. When bhakti enters house, your house becomes a temple. You like so many beautiful buildings, that house, this type of house, it should be like this, like that, so many different flares. So when bhakti enters your house becomes a temple. When bhakti enters action, whatever work we do, actions become seva. Karma Yoga. When bhakti enters work, work becomes Karma Yoga. And when bhakti enters a man, man becomes human and God also. So you can turn anything towards God, everything, pain, anger, everything, whatever you have, which would have been a weakness, which would have put you into depression, which would have put you into stress and sent you to the psychiatrist, psychologist, to the mental asylum. Now turn it towards God. The same forces will send you to non-dual consciousness, that is God. There is infinite happiness and joy and bliss and amrita. So we'll continue this study of Madhura Bhava in the next class. Today is Monday, so Thursday, we will wait for Thursday. Until then, we will meditate, we will go back, we will revise, think on this, read much more, because I've sent that notes, I've sent that ebook, PDF copy of that ebook, you will be all to all of you I have sent. So read that again and again, or if you have that great master, you can read it, meditate on that. So prepare for the next Thursday. So today evening we have the science of worship at 6 o'clock. Then tomorrow we have evening 6 o'clock, the South African time, study of Viveka Chudamani. Wednesday evening we have the study of Bhagavad Gita, the 60th verse. We may go even to the 61st verse. We are studying the different aspect. Krishna is taking us, Lord Krishna is taking us through the psychology of our mind. What is happening there? How the desires work there? How the mind works? Everything is being taken there in the 60th verse and the 65th verse. Thursday, Friday, we have the Great Master. Then Saturday again, we have Bhagavad Gita, study of Bhagavad Gita. Sunday, Monday, we have this Great Master early in the morning. So, all of you can attend these and be blessed. Think of God, meditate on God, and we can lead a very good God-centered life. So if you have any questions, if you have any doubts, you can now entertain that or you can ask. Any questions? Any doubts? Okay, if you don't have any questions, no doubts, I can now end the session with the prayer. प्रियतां पुंडरीकाक्षः सर्वयज्ञेश्वरो हरिः तस्मिन् तुष्टे जगत्तुष्टं प्रीणिते प्रीणितं जगत् हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्रीरामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु।